All right, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome back to the Real Music Observer. I'm Dave, observing real music in real time for real people just like you and just like me. ZZ Top had a song called Jesus Just Left Chicago. I don't know if you remember that. A lot of times when I think of Peter Cetera, I think he's the main character in that song. I just listened to an interview with Cetera where he's babbling on about how the record label messed up on his first album, and he had this crazy contract where he couldn't be successful. He could put out an album, but if he got too successful, then they'd kick him out of the band, or he couldn't record anymore. I was trying to understand it. And first of all, a really stupid contract, okay? Secondly, it sounds like he didn't have the blessing of the guys in the band. Chicago, let's explain Chicago again. Everything you read about Chicago, when they took the oath in Walt Pirizader's basement, and they said, you know, brothers to the end, we're going to be a faceless band, we're just going to be this band of brothers working very hard, creating rock with horns, a jazz rock-oriented band. And it seemed to do very well up until Terry Kath accidentally shot himself. Okay. After that, it seemed as though everybody was, you know, discontented. Cetera writes this ballad. It becomes a mega worldwide success, If You Leave Me Now. And then I think he thinks at that point, oh, I don't need these guys. Even though I took this pact, I don't think there was that camaraderie there. Peter was starting to kind of distance himself. And by the time he hooked up with Foster, David Foster, for those of you who don't know who the heck I'm talking about, Peter decided, hey, I can do this on my own. I got a songwriting buddy. I've got an arranging buddy. And that was true, because Foster, his whole approach helped Chicago 16 and 17. What's even funnier, though, is Foster decides to do Chicago 18, and Cetera says, no, you're not going to produce my second album. It's just, I mean, the guy, to me, it's a lot of sour grapes. The reason his first album, in my opinion, wasn't a sales success is because it wasn't anything like what we'd expect. Living in the Limelight, go listen to that. It's a great song. It's a rock radio song. It's a melodic rock gem. It's got these big fat guitar riffs. I think Steve Lukather does the guitar solo, or Mike Landau, one of those great studio guys, are in on it, and they just nail it. And Cetera is singing this song with a huge hook, and it's all over, by the way, it's all over rock stations. There was a station in Boston that used to play this night and day, WCOZ 94.5 FM. Any of you who remember that, I was up in that area, and to get COZ where I lived, you had to like tilt the antenna, and you had a little stereo indicator light would go on, and you were all like, I was like, yes, it's coming in. And you get all that static when the stereo light would come on. Just listen to it back in mono. You untune it just to, you know, but that's how much I love the radio station. And they were killing Living in the Limelight. They were playing it all the time. But everybody's like, hey, this is Peter Cetera. Isn't he that wimpy guy that sings, you know, those sort of easy listening Chicago tunes? So the record label probably said, well, this isn't what we expected. Peter Cetera says it has something to do with the contract that he signed, that if he becomes too successful, then that's bad for him, and then he might have to, I don't know, he'll have to stay in the group. I was just totally confused by the interview, and I'm confused by Cetera because he's constantly doing history rewrites here. The bottom line to Chicago is they were a group, and they believed in the group concept. They didn't believe any member of the group was better than any other member. So when Cetera became this little, kind of little star there, because he was singing lead on everything, especially when Foster took over, hey, here's a little scoop for you. David Foster didn't want to have anything to do with Robert Lamb, okay? Didn't want to help Robert Lamb. I think there's one song on 17 that I think he gave Robert Lamb a boost on. I think it's called We Can Stop the Hurtin'. But I don't think, I don't think Foster likes Robert Lamb. I think Robert Lamb does respect David Foster, because I think David Foster taught everybody in the band how to produce and arrange and do all these things. But he just glommed onto Peter Cetera, and he's like, man, you're my top five vocalist. I'm going to make you an even bigger star. And so when Peter leaves Chicago, what happens is Foster goes back and he tries to create the same magic on Chicago 18 with Jason Scheff as he did with Cetera on 17. And you know what Peter Cetera does to thank him? Peter Cetera is not happy, so he hires like Patrick Leonard or somebody like that to produce his next album. I think it was called One More Story, which didn't do very well and didn't have any of those David Foster sounds and its ego. It was ego and pride that did Peter Cetera in, and then his career just went shh like that. Where Chicago actually, toward the late 80s with Ron Nevison, still did well. It's the label, to be honest with you, you know who got screwed by the label was on Chicago 21, where Warner Brothers used the wrong mixes of that album. And they should have used the Nevison mix. Instead, they used the Gattaca mix, and the Gattaca mix is all watery and doesn't have those crisp drum beats that that you found or heard on Chicago 19. So Peter Cetera, buddy, you're not living in the limelight anymore. Time's up. Stop trying to rewrite history. It's, you know, I was there. Radio was just stunned. I tell you, they were stunned that you came out with Living in the Limelight. It did great on rock stations. It was a tremendous song. But as far as being what the label probably wanted, not so much. So there, I'm Dave. This is The Real Music Observer. We'll be back observing more real music in real time for real people just like you right there and me right here. Talk to you then.